Fresh from the showcase here at Swiss Watch Expo. Today we are dealing with watches that have a lot to do with racing history, and we have a lot of these pieces here because in history, watches and cars tend to go hand in hand. Why? Because a lot of chronographs and timing events have to do with watches, right? Whether it's horse racing or automobile racing.
Yeah, they say the first car race was when the second car was built.
Right.
So the timing had to come right in with it. But the kind of the catalyst for us talking about this today is the great movie Ford versus Ferrari that came out last year. Instantly became one of my favorite movies. I love racing movies, but this is the first one that was ever nominated for Best Picture. So it's really a good movie. The sound engineering in it is incredible. Watch it with headphones on. But you couldn't help but notice in the movie, the star of the movie, you might think it was the cars, you might think it's Matt Damon and Christian Bale. No, it was the watches. So it was hard for me to keep track of the story for having to be being so distracted by looking at the watches in the movie. And I felt a little bit weird about them because I was having a hard time thinking about the events happening being portrayed as being 64, 65, 66, and the particular watches that they were wearing. The fact is, and hats off to the costume designers and to Hoyer for getting their product placement and everything in there, those watches that they wore in the movie weren't released until later. But if they had been wearing the correct ones, it would have been really rare for anyone to have owned them at the time, and they would have been extremely expensive now to cast them. They're really rare watches. But
that happens a lot in movies, by the way.
So the one that Matt Damon's character, Carroll Shelby, wears is very noticeable. It's a white dial with black subdials. It's a Hoyer Carrera that came out in 1970. But it looks great on him all through the movie. And we have, actually in stock here at Swiss Watch Expo, a reproduction that is a beautiful watch. You probably
Altavia.
Know a lot about this watch. This one is, the Altavia was worn by Christian Bale's character, but his didn't look exactly like this. It was a different model. But this one is, I think, just beautiful. And if you like that 60s racing feel, that the whole vibe, this watch really captures that Ford versus Ferrari vibe that was going on in the movie.
I particularly like this one on the leather strap. It gives it that more vintage feel. I'm not a fan of what I call the wicker link.
Right.
Which is not the actual term, but it looks like woven wicker. It's sort of a strange combination of things, and I think it's a very strong opinion about that bracelet. Most people tend to like it on the strap, and I'm glad that we have it here. We've got it's the reverse panda dial.
That's such a good looking watch.
It really is, and the cool thing is when you turn it over and you see the back of it and you see the internal movement mechanisms, they actually made a little bit of colorized difference. And there's a lot to look at. It's not just a one-dimensional kind of watch. And it really shows off a lot of the technology that they use in this. And this is, you know, when you purchase this watch new retail, it's $5,000, almost $6,000. It's not a cheap watch. It's an in-house movement Tag Heuer. They specifically developed this for this watch. By the way, a lot of people don't realize this was a watch that was crowdsourced. So when Tag Heuer first introduced this watch, and they said, hey, we're going to build an Altavia. What do you think is, you know, people who purchase watches that this watch should look like? They picked all the design features of this, and then Tag Heuer got together, collaborated, and this is how it came out. So a lot of people that were smart about what they wanted to see in a watch chose all the design features of this based on even previous movies and racing history and all those other things. Yeah. They really wanted it to fit.
One of the cool ones we've got here right next to it, this is a not a reproduction. This is a actual 1967 Omega Speedmaster Professional.
One of the coolest watches anywhere to be found.
It is. We don't call it a moonwatch because it wasn't the moonwatch yet. NASA hadn't certified it. It doesn't have the text on the back about the first and only watch worn to the on the moon. This one is purely a racing watch.
Can I stop you right there for a second?
Yeah.
Because, okay, so there, obviously we have a lot of automobile shows around the country, right?
Yep.
The Concours d'Elegance, the Caffeine
Pebble
and Octane,
Beach and, that, yeah.
And yeah, Pebble Beach. And what I found interesting is when you walk around these events, and I haven't been to the d'Elegance and, you know, or the Pebble Beach, which I would love to go, but, you know, I don't think my suits are nice enough. So the watches that they wear typically are the moon watch. The Speedmaster, for that reason, because people always think of it as being the moon watch, but in fact, actually, it has a racing history. And even for me, I feel a little bit weird about it because it's drilled into your head. This is the moon watch, but actually, what you said is 100% correct.
And there's been a big resurgence of interest in, you know, people like these distressed straps. They like the straps that are perforated, that are, you know, drilled with the holes that are considered racing straps that were popular in the '60s. And, you know, you just saw in the 60s an explosion of creativity among the watch companies. There was kind of art movement at the time where people were unshackled. And that's where we get a bunch of these, you know, bright colored dials and new inventive shapes and a lot of neat things. But this is an authentic 1967. It's got the beautiful patina on the dial. If you really want that true 60s racing heritage feel, that one's got it all day. Kind of the next thing that happened was when, I think it was 1971, was the Le Mans movie.
Right.
And Steve McQueen was known not only as the king of cool, but for bringing his own things to movies. So, for example, in The Great Escape, the motorcycle jump, that was his own personal Triumph motorcycle. It wasn't some Hollywood prop. At the same time, they tried to get him to wear a different watch in that movie. I don't remember now what it was. You can answer us in the comments. But
Rolex.
Was it a Rolex?
Mm-hmm.
But he insisted on wearing his personal, at the time, this was the Heuer Monaco, which was a new watch out, and ever since then has now been known as the McQueen. This is the correct one, yeah, with
right.
the crown on the left.
Yeah, that's why I was pointing at that, because yep. I was hoping you were getting ready to say that.
Yep.
This is really important because the newer versions of this watch had the updated movement. This is the original movement with the crown on the left side of the case as opposed to being in the center between the two pushers. Real important. Also, the color is correct, too. A lot of the pictures that you see, you'll see the black dial. Now, interestingly enough, there were actually three versions in that movie. He wore this color, which is kind of a bluish, grayish color.
It's kind of a muted.
When it photographed, it always looked black for some reason. Now, he did wear a black one because there was more than one. They had the black dial as well. So once in a while, there's an argument about which watch you're actually seeing in the picture and which cuts you're seeing, because in some cuts, you know how, I mean, obviously they're doing scenes, they're doing it over and over and over across a few days. He could have actually picked up one that had the black dial one day and then had the blue one on the next. So,
although that movie's a little bit different because they actually filmed it during, I think it was the 1970 running of the 24 Hours at Le Mans.
Right.
And so they had a separate car that obviously didn't win the race that had cameras on it. But they really did film it during the race, which is, I mean, incredible that they did that.
Yeah, I mean, and there again, you know, watch history is huge at the Daytona. So the Rolex Daytona 24 Hour, obviously starting in kind of 1934, moving forward, when Rolex decided to start sponsoring the Daytona race, which at that time was actually on the beach, not on an actual track, that's why the Rolex Daytona is called the Daytona, because it was the official timing, the official timekeeper of the Rolex Daytona 24-hour race that we know now, the endurance race. And that was a big deal because at that time, cars were just sloppy. I mean, to get a car to run over 100 miles an hour for 24 hours in a row was almost an impossible feat. So if you're going to be consistent with durability and longevity, wouldn't you want your watch associated with that too?
Mm-hmm.
Especially with some of the finest automobiles in the world, this is the watch that you would wear. Obviously, Paul Newman, huge racer, big fan of the Daytona, always wore one. That's why they're so expensive now. You can find the name, why everybody wants the Paul Newman design with the muted gold and all that. So extraordinary history with the Rolex Daytona, and has been around for a very long time.
And talking about sponsoring events, I have noticed, you know, obviously the last, I don't know how many decades, Omega has timed the Olympics.
Yes.
And so that's been, they've continued their involvement in sports. But the one I was interested in hearing about is you told me that the Tudor is the sponsor of IMSA.
That is right, yes. So let's backtrack just a second on what you said about Omega. Let's not forget the Michael Schumacher edition Omegas. This is the reduced model. There's a 39-millimeter model as well. Each one of the colors represents each one of the wins that he had over the years, starting around 1995. So whenever you see a different color and you think to yourself, why are there so many different colors? Each color represents a different win. So every time he had a championship series win, there was a new color developed. And so each color corresponds with a certain year.
And there are a lot that have text about his number of championships that he won.
Positions.
And it has the years around the bezel. There's so
yes.
many interesting things to collect in the Schumacher series. And God help him, he is probably the greatest racer ever.
And there is the Tudor it's the left-hand dial version of this watch. What you said is absolutely correct. Now, what you'll see for the IMSA series, the big major sponsor now is WeatherTech, but Tudor was a sponsor of the IMSA series for a very, very long time. And the thing about Tudor is that they would give watches to the actual championship winner.
Okay.
There is a Grand Tour, which I believe we just recently sold. I would have used that in this video. The Grand Tour was one of the prizes that they gave to the top three winners, first, second, and third place, at the end of the year. So all the championship series winners for each one of the divisions, by the way.
And I do remember reading that Rolex does still give a Daytona to the winner of the 24 Hours at Daytona.
That's correct,
The Rolex, and in fact, I mean, it's called the Rolex Sports Car Series. And but I used to live in Florida. I actually met a guy once who came into my store who had the watch on that he had won, and you know, it was really cool.
And I've actually been to the IMSA Series Championship dinner here in Atlanta. Road Atlanta is the final race of the series and the championship series race. I've been to that dinner here and watched them give away those Tudors, so it's a lot of fun. It's a really neat event over the evening to see all those race car drivers. And a lot of people don't realize just how hard race car drivers work at their sport. I don't think they realize just how involved it is physically. It's an intense sport. Now, the only other watch that we haven't talked about is the one that I have here, which is IWC. Now, I happen to be wearing an AMG Mercedes IWC, which is obviously important to Atlanta because Mercedes has their headquarters here now. IWC is a huge sponsor of AMG Racing, Formula One, even in the IMSA series. Blancpain is another one. But the reason that I brought out this particular IWC is because I'm a huge fan of this watch. Now, I did a video on the Rocher-Pont, how to use it. A lot of people don't realize it's a split timer. We've done another video where we introduced this watch too. Huge fan of this because it's the white dial with the red and the yellow seconds hand. No other watch looks like it in the world. But the reason that this is important to racing is because it's a split timer. You measure two different series of cars. You can measure split laps. There's all kinds of things that you can do with this. So you have the Daytona, which is just a single chronograph, which is a single timing event. But then you have the split timer, which you can time multiple events with. So that's the reason that I have this one out. And of course, the AMG titanium body on my left hand here is just a chronograph as well. Just a little bit more muted. Really cool textures and design on this. Very sophisticated.
And there's lots of other great car movies with great watches. James Garner wore a lot of different cool watches in his various movies. Even going to modern times, things like Days of Thunder, a lot of watches in those racing movies. So something to keep an eye out for.
We can't finish this series off. We don't have one, but Ayrton Senna for Tag Heuer. One of the most important racers in the world ever, besides Michael Schumacher, for Omega. I think that if you think about racing, there's so many huge Ayrton Senna fans out there. If I'd had a Tag Heuer Ayrton Senna, we would have displayed it here. We just don't happen to have it. But we get them in from time to time, so keep watching.
But definitely look for that Senna movie. It's a good one.
Yeah.